So team, welcome to the session on HPQTP UFT version 12. This specific training will focus primarily on creating an advanced automation framework from ground level. So what we're going to see as part of the upcoming few hours will be the following. Here is the quick agenda for it, team. So we'll start with an intro and preparation for the entire sessions. We will go through designing the most ideal framework. When I said designing, we will talk about what are the ingredients that will go into building each. Then we will get into the structure of creating an Excel-based automation driver. We will get into some concept called as keywords, how we will use them as building blocks for automation. Then we will get very advanced into descriptive programming along with VB scripting, and we will create individual reusable functions for every keyword that we have defined. We will then get into creating a library of all the reusable functions that have been built so far. After which, we will get into more concrete stuff by talking about the test cases and test steps. We will then get to assigning keywords into an input data for each test step that we have created, followed by one of the most important aspects of the framework, that is the building a driver script as a core engine, how that is going to navigate through everything that we've built so far, the function libraries, the test cases, the keywords and so on, and go about executing it. And finally, we will end with handling errors in custom HTML reports. After we have done this, what we will be doing is primarily talking about finalization and deployment of a framework on a sample project. So this is what you're going to see in the next few hours. And as we had mentioned and discussed initially through our orientation session, the idea was we will start at a little advanced stage. This training will not go through the basic fundamental that are already been covered in the training tutorials. All right? It will start primarily where we want to start building the framework. So the initial concepts of VB scripting, how the automation typically works, the UI for QTP, talking about action checkpoints, or even concepts like descriptive programming and all of these are a prerequisite. So what does it mean? If you are someone who's attending this training for the first time and you've not gone through all of this, it is important when you're going back to revise everything that you see today, you start in the specific order. All right. So this is the primarily what we will be doing as part of the agenda of what I've shown. And here are the prerequisites for it. Now, as I mentioned, you can also go back to the orientation session and look at what I've shown, what I've covered as part of this, and you'll get a good idea of what is to be done. All right, so now that this is done, team, let me quickly go ahead and talk about how we build this entire thing. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new folder here in the Google Drive. I'm going to call this as UFT 12 Hive Training. All right, that's the name of the folder. What I'll be doing eventually is taking all the content and putting it in here and sharing this folder with each of you so you will get access to be able to take everything. I'm also going to copy the entire content from here into a new Word doc there. So quick check on my audio and the streaming. Hope all is well, team. You can use the question and answer section in your GoToWebinar to be able to interact back with me. How good is my volume? Do you need me to increase the volume at my end? Let me try. GoToWebinar is full. Looks good. Not here. All right, I believe most of you are decently okay with the volume, so I'm going to ignore that portion for now. All Now this first document in this folder, I'm going to name it as a prerequisites. So team, you will also require to do installation, and for installation there are complete welcome packs. So in case if there is any question here, I'm going to write it here. Installation of the demo version. It's actually trial or demo version. It's not a demo version, it's a trial version. It's a time limited trial version that you have. Detailed documentation with step to step instructions will be provided through the welcome pack. What is a welcome pack? When you become a premium member, you will get all these instructions in a package format through your email, and all that you could use it in your welcome pack, from your welcome pack to get started. Welcome pack will contain many of these items. These are a couple of the other items that are there in it. Alright, so that is that. And then issues, challenges and tech support through the forum. So since team, this is more like a few hours training that you're going through right now, and you will notice that we will be focusing on advanced concepts. When you go back and start reviewing and practicing, you will notice that a lot of questions will come up, a lot of issues will come up, and that's where you'll start using our forum. So here I'm going to put it the link itelearn.com/forum. Alright, so that's the tech support forum where you'll get all the help. So that's about installation of the demo trial version of HP Unified Functional Testing version 12. In fact, I think it's 12.1 right now. So any 12 plus version that we're talking about right now. Alright, cool. So this is done. Let's go back to the folder, and we're going to create another document with what we have in the agenda for the first thing. So here is our agenda team. And if we go back a little, intro and preparation, and then designing the most ideal framework. I believe we have completed the intro and preparation right now. We're going to go about design the most ideal framework. So let's talk about automation frameworks. And let's talk about what are ideal frameworks. Okay, so this is basically what we will need before we start. This is something as a ground level. It is primarily saying that if we plan to create automation frameworks, what are they and what will make the most ideal automation framework. So I need your help to design this. Now we will start with what a framework is, and then we will get into what an ideal automation framework is. Give me one second, the projector has a small issue. I need to quickly look into that. Display. I think I need to mirror it again. Display settings. It's a duplicate. Okay, at least on online you're able to see everyone, right? So I think this is fine. Let's continue. So Dean, what is a framework? That's the first thing. All right. Then we'll talk about what are the ingredients, or what do we need to do to design the most ingredients for an ideal automation framework. How do we do these two things? So help me, since most of you have gone through the basic data-driven framework that I have, and you've also probably seen some of my tutorials and a lot of free videos on YouTube, you would have probably known what are frameworks and what are the ingredients for ideal automation, for an ideal automation framework. So help me put some content to this piece. I'm going to quickly do some alignment while you provide some input here. What makes a ideal, and you'll see a lot of points repeating in these two, then we'll see. So we're trying to define a framework right now. That's the first thing. Alright, there you go. I get one. It's a guideline. Framework is a guideline. Next, what else, team? How else can you define a framework, please? How about it is a skeleton with a defined standard? So primarily, if I give you an example, it will be easier for you to go about understanding the definition of it. All right, let's talk about an example. The first example that I can take is very simple. An automation, auto, basically I'm saying car, manufacturing plant. All right, so what, look at a car manufacturing plant. What happens in it? You basically have an assembly line. All the different parts are brought together from different places. They are stored in a warehouse and they are brought onto the assembly line at the time of installation or assembling a car. So it will start with a chassis, it will start, then it will go to the engine, you'll start assembling the body, then the interiors, the electricals, all of those things, correct? All of them have a specific standard, all right? So the same plant can be used to produce hundreds and thousands of exactly the same vehicle out of the door. But then there could be modifications or models to it, all right? And team, I'm speaking a lot more than you see me typing. So you'll have to use them both together. It's just not an audio or just not a document. It has to be both together. Even audio is fine, but just letting you know that you have to have it in sync. So what do you mean by modifications or models? Modifications or models, we mean that you could change the color. You could say instead of a 6-cylinder, you may put an 8-cylinder engine. Instead of putting the classic lights, you may go for a neon or an LED lights. You will be able to say that instead of a regular material, you may want to use premium leather. And you have power seatings, power windows, so many other options that become. But there is a standard that you start with, and then there are modifications of different models that you produce. What else is there to identify what this auto manufacturing plant does? What you do there, team, is very simple. You have a specific type of vehicles that can be manufactured. So you cannot manufacture a different car altogether from this facility. You will be able to do a similar model, but once you change, let's say you need to manufacture trucks, there are a few things that you can take, but you'll have to design an entirely new automation plant or a framework to be able to design. So this type of skeleton that you design and build models. So a skeleton that is used to model actual products out of it. Alright, that is a simple example of an auto manufacturing plant. And now we will relate it to how is it related with an automation framework. Okay, we will be coming to that in a quick second. Next, let's talk about a building development. So let's say there's someone who's building a commercial complex. Alright, now what they do is same builder, okay, builder creates similar to earlier projects. What is similar in that? The how they lay the foundation, correct? How they start putting each levels or floors using steel, right? And how they go about building the columns and so on, columns and pillars for support. So if you look, as a simple building under construction, and all buildings when you see under construction will have some kind of similar traits. But then when you do customizations, you will talk about the size, right, the layout, the rooms, the lobbies, colors, exteriors, interiors, etc. Right? So you always start with something in a very simple manner. You have something very common. You build a skeleton framework, and then based on how you want to fill, you start adding structure to it. You start adding specific properties to it. Similarly, even more simple definition is a human skeleton. This is basically again the same concept. It has got a structure, right? It has got a specific look and feel. As soon as you see a human skeleton, it will all, they will all look the same. Then we will go about talking about the size, the shape, and so on. So there will be subtle differences in the sizes and shapes of a human skeleton, but then when you start customizing or putting the skin on, giving the specific all the specific body parts to it, how the hair looks, how the eyes look, how the skin looks, what kind of a size or build the person is, and so on, right? So that's where the customization starts. But there's basically a set framework. So anything that we look, that is used as a standard way of defining or building products that will result in efficiency, accuracy, and reusability. Again, there is no standard definition for it from a global perspective, but once you understand the examples, it is easy for you to define it anywhere. For example, you get into a project and you are trying to get selected into you already into a job, you're trying to get selected for a specific project within that job, and then they ask you what is your experience or what is your knowledge about frameworks. You have to first explain about what it is, what it can do, what are the benefits for it, and so on. So let's talk briefly about the benefits of this framework, of any such framework. Then we'll go very specific into an ideal automation framework. So we will talk about efficiency team, very simple, all right? So by building a standard human skeleton, or by building a standard kind of a building, how you start building any kind of a commercial complex, or even auto car manufacturing, you're talking about doing something faster using minimal resources and of high quality. This is what you will try and expect every time. Then you will also try and be accurate. When you say accuracy, your quality is of highest possibility. So by doing the same thing over and over, you are mastering one thing in multiple directions, and that basically adds to giving a lot of quality orientation team. And then finally, we're talking about reusability. What is the point of building or spending a lot of time in researching and developing automation manufacturing plants when we're not going to manufacture or reuse it over and over? These frameworks will pay out in long run as the reusability increases. If the reusability doesn't increase, then you will see a big loss or a big drop in return on investment because of the fact that we could not reuse it finally. Right? So here are some benefits that we see as part of our building an automation, building any type of a framework, any type of a structure to how we do things. Alright, so now what is a test automation framework? Again, the same thing, ERA, the concept is the same. You want to be able to have, now let's talk about the ingredients to build an ideal automation framework. We're talking about for a test automation, ideal test automation framework. What do we require here that we need to build for a test automation? Okay, so here's what I'm going to write. You can start adding what you know can be used across the QA organization. That is one of the attributes that we want to put. In the sense, it is idiot friendly. And don't get me wrong when I use those words. It is primarily to keep it very simple. It's like the KISS, keep it stupid simple. It doesn't require complex learning or training to use it. Now, let's go back and think about the examples. We're talking building development. So, a commercial builder worker is able to come in and with minimal training, guidelines and instructions, is able to start doing the work. He or she does not have to talk about structural integrities or any of those highly advanced topics of how a building needs to be built. All he or she needs to do is understand where he needs to work or she needs to work, what parts they need to take or carry, what they need to fix, where they need to put the bolts and come back. So they are more focused towards smaller things. Okay. Of course, they have to be efficient. There's no doubt about it. So ERA goes without for defaulting. Okay. Quick implementation for any new project. Why is this important? So before I go there, let's focus for one more point on this can be used across the QA organization. The reason I say this team is the typical QA orgs are built of about 70% or higher non-automation QA engineers. That means that not everyone in a QA organization has a good automation skill. So you need to be able to use them and use them to work on such frameworks. If we only focus on the 30% or lesser population, then we are not really effectively spreading it across or using the skill sets of people. That is the reason. Now, why do we need to do quick implementation for any new projects? Because in our agile world, projects are many and short-lived. So you're not getting, instead of 1 6 to 12 months project, we have many 2 to 4 weeks projects. So your project starts and ends within 2 to 4 weeks. So before that, you'll need to take the benefit of these frameworks, be able to quickly deploy them. So that is why quick implementation for any new project becomes important. Am I making sense? We are trying to build a baseline right now of how we're going to go about building an automation framework. And then we will start designing and going about building it in the next session. All right, what else, team? Tell me, what else do you think are needed to build a proper test automation framework? We can talk about very specific things like return on investment. The investment made to develop the framework needs to get paid off quickly. Why? At the end of the day, if a project needs to get approved, the management needs to look at the cost, needs to look at its advantages, the produce of what results it brings, and finally, at the end of the day, it is all on return on investment. Those are three simple words for it. So if the return on investment is positive, that is when there is an intent to go towards a certain project. And sometimes every project may have a positive ROI, otherwise it won't even get approved. But not every positive ROI project will get executed. Why? Because there are not enough resources to do it. Right? So it has to have high resource utilization. It should make sure that this framework uses many people with multiple skills and can is not leaving anything, any resources with unutilized time or effort. Then you need corporate dashboards. What do I mean by corporate dashboards? The higher management or even the management needs to get a quick look at QA process and its output. So before they take a project into production, pre-production move, this helps to identify a go or no go. So if they see that there are too many issues happening out of this project, and a corporate dashboard gives that alerts very quickly. So what's a corporate dashboard? It is very similar to your car dashboard. From a driver's seat, you are able to see how is your vehicle going. You're able to take quick corrective actions towards it. Fuel running low, you will try and find the next exit and refuel. Speed going high, you will try and control it. Tire pressure going low, you will immediately take it somewhere. Service engine oil going low, you will get it reserviced. So you are able to look at all of this information from your car driver's seat, and that is your driver's dashboard. Similarly, you have a corporate dashboard that will give how many test cases were executed, how many test cases were successfully done, what kind of an errors came out, how many were critical, how many were normal, how long did these test cases take to run, what environments is it passing, is it also mobile friendly or not, is it working correctly on different mobile devices, is it simulating users, the end users to the largest extent possible or not. So all of these details will help to decide if a specific specific release is up for a go or a no go. And for many of you who are probably hearing some of these jargons or terms for the first time, you may not be well acquainted with it, but you've got to hear them. You will eventually know them. It is okay to get to know a few terms and then go about researching what each and everything is. All right. But this is very, very important for us at a ground level to start building our most important ideal test automation framework. So far what we have done is basically talked about what a framework is. We took a few examples. We said what are the kind of benefits we expect, and to build our own ideal test automation framework, here are some of the expectations. Now we will build more of these. Okay, so quick implementation for any new project. This is the, we will go about adding to our wish list. This is more like our wish list. As we go along, we will get new thoughts, we'll get new ideas into our mind, and we will start adding to it. But now we have to start implementing it slowly. So before I go forward with the, can everyone hear me fine, team? Before I go forward, I wanted to ask if you have any questions that I can take. You could raise your hand, or you could also put in the question and answer section, please. Anyone having a question? Sudhir, do you have a question at your end? Okay, Sudhir, I've muted you back because I didn't hear anything coming from you. Sarita, I'm going to unmute you and see if you have any question. Go ahead, Sarita, you have a question? I don't think I'm able to hear you guys. My audio is turned on and it's full volume. Okay, I'm not able to hear you guys. I don't know why. Either you're not speaking or your audio is not set correctly at your end, please. So you can check. Any questions before I go forward? Let's see. All right, team, the webinar is only running for one day right now. And in fact, this is the demo class. We're going to take a 30 minutes break, and then we will communicate back up to the next steps for the paid members for the remaining part of it. Okay. So the 3 days is basically just in case the sessions gets extended and we're not able to complete in the 6 hours, then we will use the remaining buffer days for the remaining session. That's the intent. Any other questions, please? I believe nothing on the subject so far. So I'm going to continue and we will start building the automation framework. So what I do, and which is very important for you all to know why and try and recreate something similar, is to start with a spreadsheet or a documentation always in building your automation framework. All right. So we'll talk about the different steps that we've mentioned here as part of the agenda. We've talking about creating the structure for automation driver Excel. Then we will get into identifying keywords and so on. But then we will have to put all of this into steps, into a proper plan, and we will do all of that in the spreadsheet. So the name of the spreadsheet, I'm going to call it as Automation Framework. And this will be a hybrid automation framework. What is a hybrid framework? It is basically a combination of two or more. What are the frameworks that we're going to combine together? We will talk about it as we get along, because you have to get exposed to it and you will see it in a practical manner. So right now we will talk about the different steps, right? A description to it and a status. At a high level, this is what we will do, team. Steps, description and a status. So here, the first step team is, as I said, framework expectations, right? We said what we want to expect from the framework, and I'm going to say that detailed description of what is expected out of the framework. This is the first thing. And the status of it is done. I will just say 100%. We've just completed that in this document. So we're going to put it to a completed status. Now, however, you should notice that there's nothing really 100%. It is always something that we continue to do. And this is a version 2. I'll just call this as version 1.0 for now. So this is the first version for it. Let me put a little colors to the background. That way it's easy for us to. Okay, since this is 100% done, we'll just put this cell into green. All right, so I'm going to go back to the PowerPoint and I'm going to start looking at what I've put here, team, as the points, and we will go about doing it. So creating the automation driver Excel. So that is the next point. Automation driver Excel will help to structure how our framework will look and run. So what is this? I'll explain to you, team. We'll just write down all the steps first and then we'll come to it. Then we'll talk about identifying keywords. Identifying keywords. And then we will get into descriptive programming. Okay. Keyword functions using descriptive programming and VBScript. Right. And then we have function libraries. Reusable function libraries. What else? Next. Okay, test case. Test cases. Then test steps. Keywords and inputs. Test steps. Driver step. Reports and dashboard. Finally, finalization is one. And then we'll talk about a different step called deployment. what is the deployment and how we take it and implement it in different projects is something that we'll talk about. So right now this is the status team, what we have done. Okay, and we'll see all of this are zero. The reason we put everything as part of our agenda or plan is it is helps us to go in a very structured manner. The reason this is essential for any framework development is you will notice that it has to be done in a specific order, it has to be done in a specific fashion, and it requires a lot of focus in the direction that we take. So that's why we put everything and we try and follow a specific rhythm and structure. So all this will take about 6 to 7 hours for us to develop, and we will slowly get into it. Let's talk about the automation driver Excel and the need for it. Each time we talk about doing something, we will always refer back to what we expect from our test automation framework and what is the wish list for. So you have put all of these and you go back and keep referring back to it. It has to be efficient, reusable, accurate. It should be used across your QA organization. You should be able to take new projects and applications and implement it quickly. Positive ROI, high resource utilization, corporate dashboards, correct? So this is what is very critical. Now, let's talk about an automation driver Excel. I will explain to you this as a concept, then it will become easy for you to understand. Notepad, take notepad. And let me talk about this. So before we go about finalizing or deciding on what the structure should be for an automation Excel, let's talk about simple automation scripts. What does an automation script do? As I draw it on the screen, you'll get an idea. Let's say that we create a simple automation script in QTP using a record and run, or by adding objects to the repository and then writing the simple VB script to do it. Let's talk about something like a simple one as login. So what are the different steps we will use? We will say click on login, then enter a username, then enter a password, then you click on sign in or login, then you basically confirm if the login is done, correct? That is how for any online applications that you have that has a membership to it, or people or users need to sign in to be able to see the functionality, they would do this. You create such an environment and then you let it get executed on the application, right? Now, is this a good script? Absolutely yes. Why not? It is doing what the automation is supposed to do it, and it is going to go about doing it very accurately every time, right? But now, what could be the disadvantages to it? First thing, from an advantages point of view, it will be efficient because you'll see that it will do it faster than a human. So if a human takes 2 minutes to do it, this will probably take 10 seconds to do. So significant time reduction. Is it accurate? Yes, because a human may make errors, but the specific script will not, at least the manual errors. So it is also going to be accurate. Can you reuse it? Absolutely yes. You can take it and use it any number of times. Then what is a problem with such a script, which is just taking something and running? One, it is not data friendly right now. In the sense, to run this login, you have multiple scenarios. Valid user, all right? Valid user, all information correct. Valid user, login, username incorrect. Valid user, password incorrect. Invalid user, or unregistered, or new user. Or let's say an expired user, all right? There are different scenarios to the same script, to the same flow of a specific test case, right? So you can always write a test case like this. Let's go to this Excel. You've captured the screen, right team? Let me take a screenshot of this and keep it aside. Oops. What did I do? High contrast, you know. Give me a second, please. I tried to take a screenshot. Control shift. are print. Okay, hopefully it's taking a screenshot. That's fine. Even if it doesn't, it's okay because I've captured this here. Now we will gonna put it into a test case format. Okay. Then we will be able to look at how the improvement, how we design it going forward. So what we have just seen, team, is a test case. I'm gonna erase this drawing now. You have it in the video. We will talk about a new sheet here and we'll call it as a test case. So here you will have to say what is the step and what is the output for that step, right? Each step you will say, for example, click login link, and then you're going to say enter username, enter password, click sign in button, confirm sign in. So at every step you are bound to test something and know what is the expected output. Expected output and what is your real output. Right. Now, your expected output, when you click on this, is it will do something, and then you have a real output, and then finally you say the result. Is it a pass or a fail? So the challenges that is there for this specific test case is, number one, it is not test data insensitive answer. Every time you need to enter new set of data, where can we put the data? So you need to add another column here and we'll say insert one left and we'll call data. And here I need to know what is the username. Okay, username is the data. Then we need to know what is the password. And then finally confirm sign in is probably standard. So you need to change the username and password each time, and probably the message that comes, okay, login message. So you want to expose this specific functionality to various circumstances and scenarios. It is as simple as this thing. You develop a new vehicle, you want to make sure that it performs under various regulations which are government controlled, and also as per what you expect the car to do. How does it run? How fast will it go? What kind of a mileage will it perform or give? Under what conditions? How will it work if it's snowing or if it is hot and so on? So you have to test the specific product, or in this case a test scenario, against different sets of test data. So it has to be test data insensitive. All right. It is rather, it is challenging right now. Now the second challenge will be maintenance. What is maintenance? We'll talk about it. Requires code level changes. So what does it mean, team? Every time you need to change something in this flow, you need to go open the script and make changes to it at a code level. So you need to have someone who's very well versed with development, VBScript, descriptive programming, or how to use unified functional testing tool to be able to do that. And that will become a challenge by itself. You don't want that to happen. And hence, you have to have it very clearly defined here. And then what else could be a challenge? It is not linked with other test cases. From a reusability standpoint, what will happen? I may have another test case. For example, this is a banking application. The user needs to test the scenario of transferring a money from one account to the other account. As part of the transfer, one of the or the few of the common reusable steps is how the user logs in into the account and then goes about doing it, right? So just for a transfer of money, he needs to log in. Even for being able to go and check balance, he needs to log in. Even for let's say that removing funds or adding authority to it or sending anything, they need to log in. So this test case need to be repeated and reused over a period of time. How do we put that into such a situation? That is the reason we will go about designing this framework in a different way. I'm going to talk about this. I'll rename this. I'll call this as sample test case. Right? And here I'm going to call this as test cases. This is where we will list all the test cases, and then another sheet we'll call it as test steps. For now, team, I'm putting everything into this Google spreadsheet. Then we will take it and put it into MS Office spreadsheet. Okay. All right, team. So test cases. Let's talk about test cases for a while. So every test case hence needs to be uniquely defined. So once we uniquely define a test case, if I say test case user login, I can call it by name and 5 steps will get executed automatically. So every test case number one is built upon one or more test steps. For example, in a sample test case, this together is one test case. All of this is one test case. When we execute all of this, one test case gets executed. Each is a test step. Each line that you see is a test step in it. And hence, you could give it a unique name or identification for each test case. So the way we can write is something like this. I'll say TC underscore user you login. That is the name for this. All right. You can give a description as to what it does. And then we can put a result. When we ran this, is it a pass or a fail? Similarly, I'll say TC underscore user logout. Another test case which will log a user who's already logged in out. TC underscore user balance. Or we'll say account balance. All right. Then TC underscore account transfer. Some sample test cases for a simple banking application. Okay. TC underscore account. What else is there? What else can we do quickly out there? Debit. TC underscore account credit. So we are taking money out of it or depositing money into it. So each of this is signifying a specific test case by itself. What does it mean? That means that each of what you see, can be reused as and when we would require. All right. I'm just giving it a different color so that it's easy when you navigate from one document or one sheet to the other in this. Now let's talk about the test steps, not test sheets. So team, just to let you know, we're going to be ending this first session in the next few minutes. We will have about 30 to 45 minutes break. In the meanwhile, you will get a communication as to what's next. Test. Okay, now we will talk about every test step, team. The first thing you need to remember is it. What happened? Why am I not able to type? There you go. Every test step still needs to be linked to a test case ID. Then a test step ID, test step description, then any test data that needs to go into it. Then we'll talk about something called as identifier. Let's talk about identifier and everything later, and then a result. Now let's see how we go about designing this one. And we're starting with what we know as a, it seems to be a proper design. However, as we continue to grow, that is when we will make it more advanced. So we'll talk about a login test case. And a test step ID is very simple. It can be 1, 2, or so on. This is whatever steps we had put here already. I'm going to copy the steps. This is a new keyboard in a Windows machine. And I'm having a tough time altering between the control and the alt keys. Alright, so then 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 steps for this test case. So similarly, I will have TC underscore user logout. And for this, I'll have first one is confirm user is logged in. That's the first thing we may want to check. Then we will go about saying confirm. Okay, click log out link. Then confirm user is logged out. These are the three steps that we will take for this. Okay. Then we have TC, it's the same thing. Control C, Control V. And then finally TC underscore account transfer listen. As part of this team, look at what we will do. Right? This is where it should get very you should already start seeing what kind of an efficiency such kind of a framework will have. We are only building the skeleton team, how the skeleton should look. We have not yet even given it the proper shape. Okay, so we will be doing that soon, but right now it's just a very base skeleton. So here I'm going to say, first we will say TC underscore user login. So in one step, we're calling and asking them to do the entire thing. Okay, then we'll say transfer amount. Then we'll say TC underscore user log out. Now do you see, team, how we are trying to reuse? So as we build, we will talk about reusing a lot of our existing infrastructure and resources over and over again. Okay, but we should make it in a very smart manner so that automatically it will take care of all of these different factors that we've put in. Right? There are still going to be some downside to it. There's still going to be some specific investments that we need to do as part of it. But then we will need to go about it, and then we get some idea. Right. So team, any questions on what we've done so far, please? So team, as I mentioned, this is the first session, and the remaining sessions as part of the premium package, you will get an email, you'll get a confirmation in the next few minutes, and we will go about executing. So that's it for this session. There are questions, keep it handy. It'll be great as we explore further. You can feel free to contact and involve into the discussions. All right, everyone, thank you so much. Thank you for now. I'm going to end the session and restart in about 45 minutes, but then you will get the email notification about what next. Thank you all. Thank you so much. Bye.